This episode of the Jerky Boys Show with Johnny Brennan is brought to you by Gamefly. Go to gamefly.com/haha for your free 15-day trial. All right there, Twinkle Toes.
Hello.
Hello. This is Frank Rizzo.
Hello.
My name is Sal Rosenberg.
Hello.
No, not Sal. My name is Saul.
Tough guy.
Sure I do.
I don't even know you.
Yes, I do.
How you doing, fruitcake?
All right, Lynn, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll come down with my tools tomorrow and start work tomorrow.
Can I help you?
Let me speak to Herman.
This is Herman.
Herman.
Hey.
Let me speak to Herman.
This is Herman.
How you doing?
Fine, thank you.
Where's Jason?
Where?
Where's Jason? Hello?
Yes.
Yes. You got soup there?
Yeah.
I need a hot cup of soup.
Okay.
Hello?
Come and get it.
What do you mean?
Yeah, we have soup.
Yeah, was it hot soup?
Yeah, very hot.
Well, you gave Jason a soup. He spilled it all over my balls. What, you fucking laughing?
No, yeah, it's hot.
Yeah, the soup is hot. I know it's hot. My balls are all burnt off. I ought to know it's hot. What's the matter with you?
I'm sorry, sir.
I just got out of hospital.
Really?
Jason!
I'm really sorry.
Give me a beer, Jason. You're a bastard, you know that?
What can I do for that?
You're a fucking jerk.
How come?
Herman.
What?
What are you doing?
Nothing. Working hard like always.
Let me ask you something. Do you fuck Scott?
No, I'm not.
Does he have a tight little asshole?
No, he's my best friend. I don't do that thing. Who's this?
You know Scott's pussy? He has, like, a pussy lips on his ass.
Who's this?
He can talk with his ass, that guy.
Who's this?
Now, listen, I'm talking to you.
Tell me, who's this?
No, I don't want to tell you nothing.
Why not?
Because you're a stupid bastard. Hey, did you ever fuck Scott?
No.
And feel his tits while you were fucking him?
No.
He lets you do that.
Who's this? I know who's this.
Who's this?
I know who are you.
Well, you say that, but you don't know shit.
I know who are you.
Who?
Got you.
Despacho. Muy caliente. Fuck you.
The sweet Sammy Cox. See, now that's a rare character a lot of people don't know about. And it's kind of cool throwing these up front like this because, it's, you know, these are a lot of the ones that are more obscure that, you know, a lot of people are fans of and a lot of, you know, Jerky Boys, you know, true Jerky Boys fans know of. But there's a lot of people that don't know about, you know, these characters. And, you know, this is a great character, Sammy Cox. And he's going to be coming up on some new, new Jerky Boys albums and whatnot. But it's great to be able to throw them up front there so you guys can get a taste of some of the stuff that you may have never heard. And the reason for that is because that's when, you know, the internet really hit, you know, right around that time of Jerky Boys 3. And, you know, with Jerky Boys 1, my God, it was amazing because, you know, the internet really was, it's not, you know, it didn't take hold yet, like in a way where people could just, but when the internet hit right around the time of the release of Jerky Boys 3, which is a really fantastic, you know, album, it, you know, it showed because, you know, it just killed sales. And I mean, it wasn't just for the Jerky Boys, it was for, you know, the music business in general. So back then, a lot of people, you know, didn't get a chance to be introduced to Sammy Cox, but here the fuck he is right now, Sammy Cox. Herman, I love that skit, you know. It's one of my favorites to do that. That's like a really crazy, and there's a great story behind that character that we'll probably get into on another show, you know, only because I don't have the time now to get into it, but that Sammy Cox will come up again, trust me, you know. But we got to move on to the segment, the fan segment, where last week we had Dan calling in from all parts of the world. He was from over there in Canada. And he was, he was telling us stories about these fucking whales and walruses that they were choking and they were wearing breeders on the beach and all that. No, I'm like, yeah, I teased him last week about that. But no, we got to get to the fan call-in section. So it's a good time to segue. Let's get into it. All right. And remember here, guys, the number is 718-878-5668. That's the little cute little hotline to call into the show, like, you know, Skype or not. It's Skype, or, you know, you can just call in on the regular phone line and get into the show, and we can banter back and forth, and we can see what we can come up with. All right, so let's take one of these little wise ass bastards and see what they have to say. Okay. Hello.
Hey, how do you say that?
Yes, who is this?
Hi, how you doing? Can I speak to Johnny?
Who the fuck is this? At this time, of night, are you kidding me? Who the fuck is this?
Oh, I'm just a big fan. I was just calling to speak to Johnny. Did I get the right number?
Did Bobby Nobby put you up to this, that scumbag?
Oh, I have no idea who that is.
Hey, what's up?
How do you say that?
What do you say, man? What's going on?
I know who Bobby Nobby is. Don't you worry about that. From Nobby's, the balloon store.
Bobby, fucking balloons. Fly the little prick around the room. What's up?
Not much, man. How you doing?
All right. What's your name?
Paul.
How do you say there, Paul?
Yeah, I say this and that, man. It's a real pleasure to speak to you. I've had so many questions since I've been in the seventh grade, and I'm 30 now, so it's a real honor to talk to you, man.
God bless us all, right? So listen, have you been listening to the podcast?
Every single week, man. I thought it was great, too, because there's so much randomness with your calls that especially like with the Juggy Gales one, man. That I had so many questions about that one, and you answered all of them. You know what I mean? So the Hucklebuck, and you know who the hell knows what, you know.
Oh, I'm glad. That was a big deal. That, you know, people don't realize with that Juggy Gales, he was no joke. That guy was like, he was the shit back in his day. He was a big time promoter, and he was a pretty important cat in the music business, and handled and worked with some of the biggest stars. I even said too, like with the whole Jackie Gleason bit, you could see that in the episode where Jackie Gleason's dancing to the old Hucklebuck.
Yeah, see, that's a little bit before my time, so that's perfect that you know, you go through the answers like that. But still, even with, he's giving you the Hucklebuck down by the bar stool.
Yeah, well, now that's me embellishing. I love, because the word was such a great word. I started, you know, switching around and, you know, fucking with it, calling it the old Bucklebuck. And, yeah. And you know, this guy's trying to give me the old fucking Hucklebuck down behind the bar stool there. So, in other words, you know, it's great to be able to have great routines like that and great history like that and even be able to mess around and have some fun with it, you know?
Yeah, no, it's perfect, man. I've been listening every week, and I love it. And, you know, just I appreciate you taking, you know, calls from fans and stuff like that. It's awesome, man.
Absolutely, absolutely. So I'm sure you got some, you know, questions or whatever. Like I said, people don't have to just ask questions. They could do whatever the fuck they want. They could get on and do some characters and just, you know, just whatever. Slap some shit around, you know?
I'll be honest with you. I'm not that funny of a person, especially compared to you. So I don't want to bore your audience. So I figured I would just ask them a bunch of questions. I figured that they would.
What are you saying? You're like some fucking clown, like a little fucking turtle clown, like something funny. Like you like to make funny jokes, and no, you don't like that.
I'm just not good at it. You know, I have no voice capabilities like you. So yeah, I wouldn't want to waste anyone's time. You know, having to listen to my nonsense.
I'm sure you got some funny fucking lines you could throw out there, Paul.
Well, we'll see what happens, you know. But for now, if you have a couple, I have a couple questions I'd love to
ask.
Yeah,
I'm just busting chops. Go ahead, man.
Nah, I know, man. And if you set me sideways, if I'm asking too many questions,
and
if I'm
getting a little out of line, you know, I'll fucking give him a good smack to the fucking chops.
Yeah, that would be appreciated, actually. I'd be flattered. Actually, the first one I was thinking of, I'm going to ask like more like generic overall ones. You know, not really specific to any calls near the end, just because, like I said, I've been listening since Jerky Boys 1. I think since the part 2 came out, I've been listening, and then bought 1 and 2, and, you know, and I was there for the release of every other one. So, I got like a wide array, as you'd say.
Yeah.
Like if someone's real pissed off, like you called someone and they'd be on pissed, I could picture like the Big Hawk or one of like the, you know, the complete hotheads. How do you convince them to give their consent if they're like beyond pissed off? Like, I don't want, you know, you don't have my permission, but you have to convince them. How do you do it? Do you just, I'll give you $500, or what do you do? What do you tell them?
That's a very good question, actually. You know, I have to give all the credit there and the props to Harry Getzoff, who, as you could probably hear Harry in the Flower Lady skit, where I was making calls from his apartment, and that's actually my old manager.
And his batting average was like, man, he was almost batting 1,000. I think the only clearance he couldn't get was from Mr. Pickle. And, he tried and tried and he said, listen, let me come down and meet you. And I'm sure we'll have a nice talk. And the guy said, if you come anywhere near my joint, I'll break your fucking legs. So that was but there you go. That Harry got most everything. And again, too, so a lot of times we would give to their favorite charity, like the Diabetes Foundation or St. Jude's Children, whatever it took to get the clearances, you know, I would do.
And did some people ever were like, you didn't even have to do anything for them, just like, yeah, what the hell? Or even someone who said, oh, wow, I can't believe I got pranked by the Jerky Boys. I'd be flattered if you use it. Did you ever get any of that?
Yeah, most people were cool. Most people, when they knew they could, there was a chance that they would be on a Jerky Boys record, they were just elated. They were just, you know, blown away. But then you had the hard cases, like Civil War memorabilia was a real hard case. And there were a couple, I'm a little off guard here, but there was a couple of hard cases, but it didn't take much more than a couple of thousand, a few thousand dollars. And a lot of the time it was their kids or their grandchildren saying, come on, you got to do this, Grandpa. You know, you'd be part of the Jerky Boys. It's going to be awesome. So, I mean, it was a little bit of everything.
That's great, too. And I'm glad you explained the Harry Getzoff thing, because just funnily enough, I thought just from the name, you know, Getzoff, not to rag on the guy or anything, I actually thought that was kind of a made-up name.
No, the Harry's, it's. I think it's a Russian spelling, it's G-E-T-Z-O-V, but it's Harry's a great guy, and he was always, his temperament was, is, you know, a lot of people thought that I was making that character up, because one time I was in Washington, D.C., and I said, Harry, on the radio show in the morning, I said, Harry crossed the street, and he got hit by a cab, and it tore half his fucking ass off, and we had to rush him to the hospital, so we were in the hospital all night with this fucking guy, and everybody then thought I was making that character up, but no, Harry was my manager for many years, and a really great guy. And by the way, he's got a great book out now, actually. It's Eldrication. It's called Gold, the name of the book. But not just a little tidbit there. Little plug. Right. That's a little plug for Harry, too.
You know what I was also wondering, too, like it's kind of leads back to the last question. Like, did you find, like, when you were super popular, I know people like Sacha Baron Cohen and Tom Green had this problem, like, Did you ever have the problem where you were getting so big that it was actually hard to prank people, because people would immediately go, oh my God, are you the guy from the Jerky Boys? Or, you know, were you getting that a lot when, you know, especially when you're getting real popular?
Yeah, that happened. That did happen. But here's the beautiful thing, Paul. There's so many victims out there. I mean, and that's when I started doing the reverse pranks, when I had people calling me for Jerky Boys 3, which was back, I believe, in 96 or 97 or 95, somewhere, maybe even earlier, somewhere in there, where we're getting building calls up for Jerky Boys 3 and doing the reverse pranks and stuff just to change it up a little. And this way, people calling in, there's no way that they're going to think that, how the hell did they dial up the Jerky Boys, you know?
Yeah, they're like, who's going to spend money to prank me? Yeah, exactly.
Right, and then, you know, that's going back in the day. But again, too, there was call. I remember people started to go, I have caller ID. And I would be like, who gives a fuck you got caller ID? And I when they would call back, they would be cute. They would call back, and all I would do was a different character. And they were confused, because they thought they were calling back, and they had the caller ID, but yet every time they called back, I was doing a different character. So fuck you and caller ID.
Yeah, were you taping those? Like, is there any chance that, like, us fans would ever be able to?
You know, I'm sure I have somewhere I got probably that shit, but, you know, it never amounted to anything, because it was just some jackass thinking he was cute with caller ID. So if it was worth anything, I would have put it out there.
Oh, so nothing that great. Oh, okay.
No, it was just more or less me getting pissed off at some asshole who thought he was cute.
The reason I was going to ask was because I was wondering, too, like, for example, when you put an ad out for the game shows, like, we put you in your favorite game show, the only call you really got was the need for the Jeopardy phone call.
There was a few great calls I got from that. I got all kinds of lawn and garden equipment and chainsaws and lawnmowers. You know, with the Chinese guy that wants the fucking lawnmower. And I said, what do you want? I said, what do you want? The ride I want or the one you walk behind? And he's like, oh, no, I'm an old man. And I told him, I said, you is a lazy motherfucker, ain't you? And he gets all offended. He's like, no, I'm an old man. All he was looking for was simple. I go, what do you want, a TV on the goddamn thing too? You know, and it was just that fun. I love that big old badass Bob. But I had a lot of good shit coming in with those reverse pranks. A lot of
I didn't mean the only one you got was Jeopardy. What I meant was the only one that you got related to, like, game shows, for example. I would have thought you would have gotten, like, a couple hundred phone calls of people wanting to be on game shows, and the only one you really played was the Jeopardy one. Did you get a bunch of phone calls and that we've never heard for any reason? Yes,
I did. And I'm going to be releasing a few of those. But here's the weird thing, though. A lot of them, you'd be surprised, because they're actors and stuff. They're all excited about being in Hollywood and being on shows and whatnot. So the weird thing is they didn't really have much to offer in the way of... There was nothing really, there was only a couple that were funny, and it was only because I had to go really kind of overboard to, like, stir it up. But, you know, that guy that was the Jeopardy thing worked out great, because he was such a nice guy. He was hanging in there and wanted it to, you know, when I'm hitting him with the lines like, "Son, do you got corn cobs in your fucking ears?" And he's like, "No, I do not." And he hung in with me the whole time because he really wanted to be part of it. And it wasn't until the end of the call that he actually worked up the nerve to say to me, "You know, can I ask you a question? You know, why are you screaming and yelling and cursing?" And that's where I went off on him. I said, "Well, what the hell is the matter with you, Willie? You're from the Bronx and you're fucking asking me why I'm talking like this. What am I, a fucking paradiddle?" You know, and it fucking turns out, a funny thing is he's when Harry met him, he was a decorated Vietnam veteran. So he was a really good guy, and we took care of him. And I forget what he had a good charity, but we gave to that charity for Willie Johnson. Great guy, very nice guy.
And the phone calls we didn't hear, you know, you're saying one day, like, maybe you'll...
Yeah, there's like one or two that are really, really good. And I just never put them out because, you know, I don't even really know why. I just, you know, but again, I might have 10, maybe 15 calls, maybe less than that, that are just hit sitting around that could go out and people would probably love them.
Yeah, I think I speak for every fan who we would kill to hear stuff that didn't make it to the album for whatever reason. Just because of the content,
well, I'll get it out there. But anyway, it was, you know, it was these segments. So this is cool. This is a fan segment. They run, it's about 11 minutes now. So anything else, Paul?
It's about 11 minutes now. I'm sorry. All right. I'll cut it short for you there. But I guess the one I have to ask about is this is my favorite phone call of yours. I know it's like picking out your favorite kid, but the one, The Need to Dance, where you seem to know this guy that you're calling, Nelson. So... what's like the backstory there? You tell him, you know, and the guy's such a raging lunatic that I have to imagine that was a setup call. I mean, you knew his name and you knew he was, I'm assuming, knew he was going to be a complete psychopath with, like, no patience. So if you could give us the story on that, I would love to hear it, and the fans would too, I'm sure.
Absolutely. And that's a great call, and I will. And it was an inside job. It was a few people that were involved in the studio. And I'll elaborate on that, and then we'll smack him in the mouth with that fucking call, that's a funny call. That's a great classic Jack Torrance, you know, where he's just getting pissed off. And funny enough, too, it wasn't just Jack getting pissed off. That other guy was fucking like a little whining little jackass, right?
Oh, no, I don't have time for this. So why are you telling me this? Do I care?
What the fuck do I care? So who gives a fuck? So what are you telling me for? That guy was fucking great. And you could see, like, Jack Torrance was getting just as snippy and bitchy with him.
Oh, that was one of the rare calls where I actually was using the person you were calling's lines in real life. You know, like, I think every Jerky Boys fan uses some of your lingo in real life. But I was actually, if my mother was telling me some boring story, why are you telling me this? Do I care?
No, why are you telling me this? Who gives a shit? What do I give a fuck? But
you're
wasting that's
my time in useless nonsense conversation that is going nowhere
and has no directive. Yeah, that was a great line. Yeah, all right. So I'll definitely get into that, and we'll share that with the fans, Paul. I want to thank you very much for calling in.
Thanks, man. Thanks for everything you're doing. Love the podcast.
Hey, thank you, Paul. Appreciate it.
Take care. Bye bye.
All right. See you later. Thanks. Okay. So you see, now there goes Paul with his cute little fucking mouth, running his mouth like a little fucking tulip, you know, like a little paradiddle over there. Like he knows all the fucking questions and all the answers at the same time, you know? Like in testing for Jeopardy. He knows everything, little wise mouth fuck. Nah, I'm only shitting with you, Paul. Thank you for the, thanks for the calling and thanks for the input and the questions and whatnot. And that Nelson skit, yeah, absolutely. Inside job. Somebody had, you know, friends of friends had given it, and you know, it didn't matter anyway. This little fucking prick that was working over there at MTV was a little nasty little fuck, so he got what was coming to him. He got what he deserved, that little bastard. So check it out. The Need to Dance, Jack Torrance.
Programming.
Hello.
Hello?
Yes, Nelson, please.
Speaking, hello.
Nelson?
Yeah.
Hi. How are you?
Hi, who's this?
How you doing, Booster? Hello?
Who am I speaking with, please?
This is Jack.
Don't recall.
Really? You're in charge of the programming, right?
Not true.
What do you do?
Digital programming coordinator.
Right, but don't you put on videos?
Not necessarily.
That's weird.
What about pertaining to?
What about the dance mix? Well, it's pertaining to me getting down there and dancing.
Hang on a second, okay?
Hurry up.
Go ahead.
There's a lot of funky shit was going on. You know?
Whatever.
Oh, what's going on with you? The attitude, I sense it.
I know, it's an attitude on purpose. I'm really fucking busy to be fucking bullshitting on the phone right now, so
yeah,
how can I help you?
I want you to get me to do some dances in the videos.
Go down to the club or some fucking shit like that. I don't have time for that right now.
Nelson, is there any... Oh.
Programming.
Nelson?
Speaking.
Yes, Eric told me to call you. That's the only reason. But I seem to be breaking balls or something.
I'm really busy, though. I mean, what do you need?
Well, Eric said that you could squeeze me in a couple of these little dance mix things.
What do you mean? What exactly is it that you're talking about? I don't know what the hell you're talking about.
Well, for one, I'm a dancer, and I'm coming to you for help, and you're just shunning me. You're kicking me like a dog.
What the hell is it that I need to give you? What do you need? What do you want?
Eric said you could squeeze me into videos.
Who gives a shit what Eric says? I don't understand what Eric is telling you anything.
Well, he said that you could help me.
That I can help you what?
I'm a dancer choreographer. I do that for a living. I'm awesome.
All right, then call the...
I'm starstruck.
Call the dance studios or something. I mean, this is music videos.
I know.
What does that have to do with dance?
But that's my specialty. I'm a humdinger when it comes to this.
Who gives a shit? Why are you telling me this? Do I care?
Why are you being like that?
Because I'm really busy, and you're really taking up my time right now in useless nonsense conversation, which is going nowhere, has no directive. I mean, how the hell can I help you?
If Eric said that you could put me in a dance video...
I said I don't give a fuck what Eric says. How can I help you? What do you need?
So
what Eric said.
So Eric has no pull.
Who gives a shit? What do you need?
I need to dance, you fucker. Don't you see it? I need to dance. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to dance all over you, you scumbag. I'm going to do a dance right in your fucking ass.
All right, you do that, all
Are
right?
Are you crazy?
You do that, thanks. Bye now.
You fuck.
Oh, man, apparently Eric doesn't carry, you know, he doesn't carry that much weight. You know, he's, you know, here I'm throwing the name around 1,000 times. It was an inside job, and I guess that Eric didn't carry too much weight. This guy was just a nasty son of a bitch, but he was funny as shit. Nelson? Nelson. I love that. When he hung up on me, it was classic. So there you go, Paul. That one's for you, Booster. I really hope you enjoyed it, you little ungrateful son of a bitch. No, I'm just kidding, Paul. Thanks for calling in and appreciate the questions and, you know, great job, man. And, you know, keep listening, keep tuning in, keep spreading the word. I really appreciate it, man. So I hope you guys all enjoyed the show this week. I had a lot of fun. It was really cool to go back to some of these characters that even I haven't done or heard of in a long time. So thanks again. I really appreciate it. And let's kick some ass again, you know, with the next show. All right. So I'll see you guys next Monday. And definitely, you know, send in some feedback, man. Please. The number is 718-878-5668. That's the Jerky Boys Show hotline. Skype or regular phone, just call in, leave the messages, and have some fun. Here it is again, 718-878-5668. Just call in and shoot some shit, man. There's no reason not to. Let's go. Let's get moving. Grab your ass by the seat of your pants. Let's go, fuckers. And don't forget to go to Gamefly.com/haha and get your 15-day trial from Gamefly. They have over 7,000 titles to choose from. All game system handhelds, no late fees, free shipping, cancel anytime. That's Gamefly.com/haha to get your free 15-day trial. Gamefly, games delivered. All right, there, my friends, and don't forget to check me out on Facebook.com/JerkyBoysJohnny, you know, and leave some little messages or whatever, you know, throw some shit at me, you know, or at JerkyBoysJohnny at Twitter, or Twitter at JerkyBoysJohnny. I don't know how to fuck, you know, we'll figure this shit out, we'll get through it, or at thejerkyboys.com. Go to the website, thejerkyboys.com. You can get some cool shit there. You know, I sign some shit, sign albums, CDs, posters, whatever the fuck you want, nice Christmas gifts, all good shit. You know what I mean? And, you know, the Skype thing, but don't be afraid of that Skype thing. You know, it doesn't matter. You could just call in. So the number is 718. It's the Jerky Boys Show hotline. The number is 718-878-5668. That's 718-878-5668. And don't worry about, you know, Skype is there. It's fine. But if you have, just call in. It's all good to go. We're ready to roll, you fuck. So give me a call there, you little fucking milky liquor.